Thank you. Warm welcome to the 14th meeting of the Constitution Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee in 2022. Our first agenda item is a decision on taking agenda item 4 in private. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. Our second item is evidence session on the implementation of the UK-EU Trade and Cooperation Agreement. This is our second session in a series of meetings focusing on post-EU constitutional issues. And this morning we're joined in the room by Professor Ian Forrester, very warm welcome. And online we have Professor Catherine Barnard, Deputy Director of the UK in a Changing Europe, Professor of European and Employment Law at the University of Cambridge, also Dr. Fabian Zulig, Chief Executive of the Chief Economist of the European Policy Centre, and Professor Christina Ekes, Professor of European Law, University of Amsterdam, and Director of the Amsterdam Centre for European Law and Governance. And Professor Forrester is Honorary Professor of European Law at the University of Glasgow, former Judge and General of the General Court of the European Union. I welcome you all to committee this morning. We also have had apologies for Professor Elaine Fahey, Jean Mooney Chair of Law and Transatlantic Relations at the City Law School. We have four main topics this morning, which we're hoping to spend some time on, and hopefully we can be quite strict in keeping to those subject areas. So our first theme is the policy content and operation of the TCA, which includes commitments in a number of devolved policy areas and commitments to non-regression. And to open the questions from the committee, I'm going to invite Mr. Cameron.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. I'd like to ask about the policy content and operation of the TCA, and in particular, where the TCA touches on devolved areas of policy. And I just wondered if each of the witnesses could think of examples where the TCA may indeed have a sort of practical impact on devolved policy areas, and whether they foresee any particular sort of flashpoints in those areas. And if I could start with Fabian Zulig, please.
Yes, thank you very much for inviting me to give evidence today. I think, firstly, to say the TCA is, of course, a very wide-ranging agreement. It covers trade in many different areas. So I would say it has a general impact on the economy, on the way the economy functions in exchange, particularly with the European Union. But specifically, there are some areas which was already referred to when it comes to those areas which are covered by the level playing field conditions. So in particular, I would highlight here environment, climate change action. There are some implications from the non-regression provisions which are there. Not the only area, but I just wanted to highlight that one as a starting point.
Thank you for that. And Professor Catherine Barnard, please.
Yes, I broadly agree with that. What I would say is, in fact, the TCA is very thin. Well, it's not in numeric terms, it runs well over 2,000 pages, but thin in content. And in fact, the TCA moves us quite a long way from even Norway or Turkey. It's a very much a mid-Atlantic agreement with rather limited expectations and ambitions. In fact, the areas highlighted on your list are those that are most likely to impact upon devolved matters. I would also like to flag up fisheries. Fisheries had the potential to be a flashpoint last year, and indeed we saw the gunboats being sent to the waters around Jersey and Guernsey. But it does look like that some careful technocratic work has actually resolved some of those issues. Of course, the issue about fisheries comes up again for review in 2026, and it's tied up with the energy policy provisions. Although, in fact, at the moment, we're seeing the boot is somewhat on the other foot in respect of energy, because at the moment, we, the UK, are providing a lot of the LPG and the offshore LPG offshore for the EU, and also a lot of the green energy for the EU, given the issues about the war in Ukraine and issues about energy provision. So the energy provisions won't work quite in the way we expected beforehand.
Thank you for that. And Professor Christina Eicks, please.
I mean, only in addition, I would like to flag social security as an issue where we equally have the agreement of non-regression, hence we cannot lower the standards, social and labour rights. And in fact, many of these rights depend very much on national legislation. So while the TCA is very thin, we require regulation at the national level, and here it must be implemented in a way that that meets the requirements of the TCA and that is nonetheless determined by the provisions of the TCA. So with specific Scottish regulation on that, there could, of course, be an issue if there's a divergence.
Thank you. And finally, our witness in the room, Ian Forrest-Kesey.
Okay. Well, I agree with everything that's been said. Let me add two things. I was a judge for 5 years, but I was a practicing lawyer in Brussels for 40 years, doing technical regulatory work, competition and so on, in a whole slew of different industries. And I think it's relevant, as Catherine said, the TCA is kind of thin. So how are decisions taken today in Brussels and in other areas, other specialised agencies? We have it's one example, feed, animal feed. It's easy to say you can only give to your animals healthy feed. It's very difficult, and it must necessarily be very prescriptive to agree on which chemical is or isn't appropriate for which animal at which stage in its life. The process of discussing whether virginiamycin is good for turkeys involves expert committees, scientific committee on animal nutrition. Now, those committees are the forum for hashing out technical disagreements. Now, the TCA doesn't prescribe how technical disagreements are going to be addressed. And I can see literally hundreds of areas where there will be maybe potential conflicts about matters which seem obscure, but which are driven by experts and which ultimately touch environment, animal welfare, and many other topics. Just that by way of introduction, how decisions are made is to be contrasted with the general provisions of the provisions of the TCA. And one additional element where there may be trouble and controversy, and where there should be controversy, is to do with people like me, citizens who are living in a country other than that of their birth, people who, until the referendum and the actual occurrence of Brexit, believed that they were European Union citizens and had rights in that respect. And there's millions of such people, and their interests have not adequately been considered by, I would say, the UK side thus far. That's not an adequate answer to your question, but it is an answer.
It's a very helpful answer, because it actually leads me on to my second question, rather the point you made at the start, which is about how decisions are made and where there's disagreement. How would you see divergence between the UK and the EU being managed under the TCA or under any arrangement, if that happened? And as a follow-on, could such divergence at UK level ultimately have an impact on devolved competences?
Well, I make a frankly political point, first of all, which will not astonish you, and that is that divergence is not to be confused with, it should not be regarded as a badge of sovereignty. It should not be regarded as a badge of freedom. And I'm sure you know that that every country in the world which is sovereign enters into contractual relations with other member states. So it is false to suggest that sovereignty takes us anywhere in the analysis of these problems. That is the point of obvious point of departure. Now, divergence, especially in technical areas, especially in medical, social, food, many areas, is certainly liable to lead to controversy. So the farmer who uses an unapproved additive or an unapproved pesticide, or the manufacturer of the pesticide or the opponent of the pesticide, is likely to be affected in their pocket by the emergence of a controversy. Now, how will these things be managed? They should be managed by intelligent discussion and the pursuit of the notion of prosperity, stability, continuity, and not by the interests of a particular political party or faction in UK public life. Now, the notion that it is a proof of independence, a proof of a badge of independence to have a different rule from the European rule, which the UK has contributed heavily, remarkably well, to developing over the past 40 years, that is a political problem. In my experience of trade disputes in Brussels, the technical issues are frequently easily, maybe painfully, but not with great difficulty, resolved by discussion between technical experts and then ministers. Now, if a British minister decides the pesticide is, after all, good, when it has been decided to be bad in Brussels because of recent information, then I can see that the minister is tempted to make a decision for the entirety of the United Kingdom. And I can readily see that what the minister would wish is different from what the Scottish government would regard as things within its competence.
Thank you for that. Can I turn to our other witnesses? Professor Christina Ikes, first of all, I don't know if you have a view on managing divergence between the EU and the UK.
Yes, if there are divergences, or let's say disputes, controversies, they would first go into consultation, and that is there the Partnership Council has a core role. And I think what one must realize that the TCA is in actual fact an externalization of, internationalization of political life. So many of these decisions are then taking place outside of the ordinary political structures. And one core question that one needs to ask is, of course, what is the representative structure in the Partnership Council? What is the influence? What is the level of information ex ante, so before the decisions are taken? So in my view, it is key to resolving these issues. So the Partnership Council is the first port of call, both for operative decisions and for consultations. And I think key is that Parliament, at all levels, is informed beforehand what are the disputes coming up, can give input, that there's representation in the Partnership Council, which ultimately under the TCA is a decision that is internal to the UK. So that is a question of what access do you have, how timely is your access to information, and what is the input you can give. And then, of course, we have all the specialised committees. And yes, to a degree, you could say that technical issues are, no, I agree with that, can often be resolved at a technical level. But I mean, let us not underestimate that technical decision also often have a political dimension and a political background. So while it is it should maybe not be struck up as an issue of sovereignty. Nonetheless, there could be differences in interest that also trickle down into the specialized committees. And here's, of course, the problem. While in the Partnership Council in the past, in the first meeting, Scotland, Wales, Northern Ireland were represented. So I suppose this is also a practice that will continue. The question is what happens, for example, if we move to arbitration, to the level of arbitration. So if we move from consultation and that is unsuccessful, and we move to a situation of an expert panel where we're suddenly facing three people considering the issue of divergence, what is the representation and the level of access to information when we're going down that route? And that is something that I find would deserve attention.
Thank you. Dr. Fabian Zuleg, please. I don't know if you've got any observations.
Yeah, let me make three general points and then go in a bit more detail on the type of diversion. But the general points, firstly, I think, is that to manage a relationship which is as complex as the one we have here, to manage the TCA in a way which makes it work most effectively, requires trust. And that trust is needed so that there are these kind of conversations about technical issues, about how do you resolve some of the smaller issues. Because if you have to go into a whole big political process to deal with any areas of divergence, it becomes unmanageable. My second point, and I just put that aside, I think we'll come back to it later, but I think the question of Northern Ireland and what impact divergence has specifically on Northern Ireland is a separate issue which needs to be looked at in more detail, because there we then come into the question of what kind of checks are necessary between Northern Ireland and the rest of the UK. And my third point is one thing which hasn't really been discussed very much is the question of EU divergence. We generally talk about UK divergence, but there are many things which are happening in the EU, particularly at this moment in time. So the EU is changing very rapidly, also in some of the areas which are relevant for the TCA. But coming to divergence, I think it's important to notice that, firstly, there is inherent divergence. The moment we had this agreement, we had a separation between the UK market and the EU market. And that means there is a divergence there, which implies that there has to be friction. And that friction we have seen already on the borders. Second point is divergence is not disregarding the provisions which are there. So what we have at the moment with the threat of not applying certain parts of the agreements between the EU and the UK is not divergence. That's breaking the agreements which are there. Thirdly, I think when it comes to divergences covered by the TCA, there is a mechanism within the TCA to go through that, but it can be a very lengthy and cumbersome process. And my fourth point really is about also divergence outside the scope of the TCA. There are many areas which are not covered in the TCA where we have this very thin agreement. So in those areas which are not covered by the TCA, if it is economically relevant, then divergence simply leads to non-access to EU markets. So if there are significant divergence in areas, for example, to do with data protection, with the way certain things are applied at the UK level, then that would simply stop access to the EU market if it's no longer compatible with EU provisions.
Thank you very much, and thank you for making the point about EU divergence as a possibility, because I think, as you're right, we think primarily in terms of UK divergence, but that was a very helpful observation. Can I lastly ask Professor Catherine Barnard for her view?
Thank you very much for that. First point, divergence is allowed, and that's actually clearly stated in the TCA. Of course, the caveat to that is it engages a level playing field provisions in the areas covered, And as Fabian's just said, it may have the effect of stopping our goods or our services getting onto the EU market. The second thing to note is what is actually happening. There is it's really difficult to track down exactly what's happening both at EU and UK level. And one of the things that has been lost, I think, in the post-Brexit world is that very careful scrutiny of matter of what's going on at EU level to see how divergence is occurring. And also the hundreds of statutory instruments that come from the government. Are we properly checking? What's the mechanism for checking whether there is divergence? And this is a particular issue for whether we accidentally lead to a triggering of the level playing field mechanism, because there is a lack of awareness that a particular regulation may in fact lead to a triggering of the level playing field mechanism. Remember too, building on what Fabian has said, that when we're thinking about divergence, there's both active and passive divergence. Active divergence is where the UK, for example, deliberately decides to do something different to policy choices made by the EU, gene editing being a very good example of that. But there is also an ongoing process of passive divergence, which is where the UK is not keeping up with EU rules, because, of course, we are no longer obliged to do so. Certainly in the UK as a whole, I know it's different in Scotland in some areas, in respect of the post-Brexit period. Which brings me to my next point, which is what are the institutional mechanisms both at UK level and devolved level for mapping that divergence, and what are the institutional mechanisms for actually ensuring that Scotland has some sort of say over those areas where the UK is making a conscious choice actually to diverge. Yes, I know about the various interparliamentary committees that are being set up, but are they really enough to do the close work to work out what does divergence actually mean? And of course, my final point relates to the Internal Market Act, because while we're looking at a complex multidimensional jigsaw UK-EU, if Scotland wants to diverge as well, how that sits with both the Internal Market Act and the Common Framework provisions.
Thank you very much for those very illuminating answers. And back to you, Convener.
Thank you. I can invite Mr. Russell.
Thanks, Convener. I was just reflecting actually on a point that Ian Forrester was making about that European Union approach to very in-depth working with scientific advisers, industry bodies, environmental NGOs, stakeholders to develop policy. I mean, do you and other members of the panel see a mismatch or a growing divergence between that well-established approach within the European Union that the UK has been very much part of over many years, and what we're now seeing in terms of how policy is being developed in the UK? And I think, you know, the example Professor Barnard was using there of gene editing might be an interesting one in terms of, you know, the robustness of the conversation that may be happening in the EU compared to what's being proposed here. Fisheries might be another area. Could I go back to Ian first and then?
Sure. First point, there is in public discourse at the moment a disparaging of retained EU law, because it's retained EU law, it's medieval, it's like Magna Carta, we want to escape from that. That's a dangerous point of departure. It's seductive because we've left the United, the European Union, so it's wonderful, some might say. But the disparaging of the rules which the UK helped to draft, which are highly technical, over the past 40 years, and in the drafting of which UK officials were exceptionally successful. The UK and France were the two countries which had the most success in tweaking a text to be favourable or friendly to their particular national interests. So, first thing to say, there's nothing wrong in retained EU law, except apparently the title. Now, Next observation is a constitutional one. The way in which texts are drafted in Brussels involves a great deal of consultation with technical committees, with national experts, and with national policymakers. So the Portuguese and the Swedes may have different views about animal welfare. It doesn't make either of them wrong, but they are different. Now, the hammering out of a compromise about one of these questions takes months, maybe years, but when it's finished, it's pretty good. Now, if we discard that lightly, then that may have technical problems for UK interests. But moreover, there's a constitutional problem. If a text which has been drafted carefully, exhaustively, following a lot of expert input, is simply discarded, then, or is to be discarded by a minister, then I would worry constitutionally if the supervision of that choice has been constitutionally adequate. According to the BBC, there were something like 80,000 or 90,000 texts which constituted the corpus of European law. And I think it is really important that how these are adapted into UK law and into Scottish law, how they are adapted is something that is really constitutionally very, very important. And I don't think it's satisfactorily being done at the moment. Catherine Barnard likes to remind us that the last time a statutory instrument was blocked in the UK Parliament was 30 years ago. Now, once a minister has decided it's going to be 3.2% and not 4.1%, that's something that should be carefully considered, and it shouldn't lightly be passed into a statutory instrument.
Thank you. We perhaps underestimate how much work goes into hammering out agreements across the EU and lessons here across the UK. Can I turn to Catherine Barnard then?
Yes, so on your... Thank you for that. I'm just getting some feedback, is it? Oh, thank you. Thank you for your question. In terms of the institutional mechanisms, how much engagement is there between the UK and the EU over these matters? I'm afraid the answer is actually rather little. Yes, there is the institutional structure of Partnership Council, and then more importantly, the specialist technical committees sitting under those. I understand every single committee has now met once in the course of 2021, but the fact they only met once suggests that there is not very intense engagement. Now, there may be some more informal engagement, and certainly UCMIS in Brussels has an important role there. And I note that UCMIS is four times the size of the equivalent offices elsewhere. So UCMIS clearly are doing important work. But in terms of this engagement in the real detail, the answer is no, because, of course, from the UK government's point of view, the answer is we are free to do what we like. We do not need to cooperate with the EU. And this is where the tension arises, because the tension arises in the field of goods in particular, because our supply chains are still so closely interconnected with those of the EU, and therefore our manufacturers will have to comply with provisions of EU law on the making of widgets for headlights for cars, because otherwise the manufacturers of car headlights will not be able to sell those car headlights as part of a supply chain into the EU. So there is a tension between what manufacturers want in the UK and what the UK government actually wants to do.
Thank you. I don't know if other panellists would like to come in at all. Fabienne?
Yeah, thank you. I'm not wanting to make a point on internal UK systems, because that's not my area, but I just wanted to make two points of a more general nature. One is, as long as there is an economic relationship what is decided in Brussels matters hugely for the UK economy and for UK businesses. But the UK's ability to influence those decisions has been vastly reduced by Brexit. So now it is a question of having the much more informal way of influencing it, which actually means you have to invest far more because you are no longer automatically in the decision-making bodies. And that also, in my view, applies to Scotland. So if Scotland does want to have an influence on some of the legislation which comes out of Brussels, which in the end, in many areas, will have to be adopted by the UK. So the UK is now really a rule taker in many areas, unless it chooses to diverge, which has consequences then in terms of market access, in terms of being integrated. And my second point is, I think there's a major difficulty in translating some of the decisions which are taken at the European level to the UK at whatever level, because there's a lot of interpretation. Many areas of EU law are directives, so they set a general goal, but the actual implementation is down to the member state. So the question is, how do you then interpret that? How do you make sure that the interpretation which is put onto that kind of legislation is still consistent with the overall laws? That is something which within the European Union is checked by the European Court of Justice, but there is no such equivalent for the UK.
Thank you. Christina, do you wish to come in on this as well?
Yeah, maybe just with a brief point that I see the tension arising above all if there's the intention to maintain EU standards in Scotland, and then the tension with the Internal Market Act and how that is resolved. So I personally see that the tensions that might arise don't go up to the TCA level. If they do, they might have repercussions for things that that are not actually, that are the intention to diverge from the EU standard, but that might not actually be the case in the devolved policies.
Yeah, thank you. Back to you.
Thank you. Dr. Allen?
Thank you. I wonder if Professor Forrester, you could elaborate on a couple of interesting points you made. Firstly, you talked about the thinness of the TCA, and I just wondered if you could say, firstly, a little bit about why you feel it's so thin and what that means.
I've been a practitioner for a long time, and I was, for a shorter time, a judge. The European institutions work on a basis of consensus. It's highly political. And the court is quite rarely involved in the settling of major controversies. That's a very big statement, and there's lots of exceptions. But the TCA has a nice framework for consulting between the two sides, between the 1 and the 27. And there's nothing wrong with that, but much depends on the political will of the government of the United Kingdom, and not very much on the political preferences of devolved administrations. So when we say that the TCA is thin, it's kind of aspirational. It offers a framework for consultation, but there has to be consultation which is effective, which is ongoing. The standard for animal welfare or for headlights is the subject of discussion, and outcomes a proposal. And this is within the 27. And the Italian side says, no, that doesn't work. And the German side, okay, how about this? And the Commission comes in with a compromise. Now, that ongoing discussion, which precedes the final stamping of the text, takes months, years, and a whole lot of people are talking to each other, frankly. But the TCA is hampered by the absence of those daily communings back and forth. It could be the vehicle for that, but as we heard from Catherine Barnard, the committees which are set up don't meet.
Well, turning, I suppose, from the relations between the UK and the EU and thinking of where, if at all, this fits into the relations now between the UK and Scottish governments. Again, I wonder if you could offer any observations about that, particularly now that we may be entering a period where not only is a policy disagreement between the two governments, but the two governments may have a different understanding of what is or should be devolved.
Yes. The bad news is that it's the UK who will be defending the compliance of the UK with, and including Scotland, with provisions of the TCA or other legal instruments. Devolved administrations are at a disadvantage. I don't wish to make a... devolved administrations are devolved administrations, and therefore they are not member states and they are not the United Kingdom. And the European Union has a tradition of dealing very cautiously with devolved administrations, that you well know. On the other hand, Scotland has an exceptionally high level of recognition in Brussels, in Strasbourg, in Luxembourg, saying that je viens de l'Écosse. That's instantly recognisable. The statue that sits in my court is on loan from the National Gallery of Scotland, and the First Minister has said she wants it to stay there. So Scotland has a very high political level of recognition, but on the other hand, institutionally, constitutionally, the Scottish government is a devolved administration. It's not the government of the United Kingdom. So I would very cautiously and respectfully hope that Scottish officials and ministers continue to be visible, audible, intelligible, moderate, clear in Brussels and Strasbourg and Luxembourg.
Thank you.
Thank you. If we could move to our second theme, which is around the accretion. Sorry, I wasn't able to see that. Catherine, please come in. Professor Bernard.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I just thought it might be helpful supplement Professor Forrester's very helpful answer on why the TCA is thin. If I just give you a couple of examples to explain why it's described as thin. Take goods, for example. There's no general rule on free movement of goods. It just applies the rules in GATT. Plus a bit with zero tariffs, but zero tariffs require rules of origin. There is very little on trade facilitation, which would have been a very positive thing, almost nothing in the treaty on that. On services, again, very thin, and even Lord Frost himself admitted just how thin it was, which means that the mobility of people provisions are very difficult to use, and we know that. We've heard a lot about orchestras, we've heard a lot about musicians. There's no mutual recognition agreement, no mutual recognition of even of testing, so everything has got to be retested before it can be sold in the EU. There is also no provision, substantive provision on mutual recognition of professional qualifications. It's all got to be renegotiated on a profession by profession basis. So just to give you a flavour of why this agreement is described as very thin, and in places it's thinner than the agreement that the EU has with Canada, albeit it does go further in respect of law enforcement and cooperation.
Permit me to add, with a certain degree of passion, that these gaps in the institutional provisions were identified, predicted, defined, spoken about by a whole bunch of people, including European judges. And we are where we are, not because someone must have been surprised.
Thank you, Professor Forrester. If the members online could indicate in the chat that they want to come in, and the clerks will pass it to me, because I often miss it if somebody's got a hand up at a particular time, but thank you. Now we're going to move to the theme around the accretion of executive power resulting from the TCA, and I'm going to invite Sarah Boyack.
Thank you very much, Convener. I'd like to move us on to the issue of accountability at the parliamentary level, both in terms of the UK Parliament and in terms of the devolved parliaments across the UK. The paper by Paul Craig for the Law Review was quite strong about the discretionary nature of the Parliament Partnership Council. I think the point made about it was a very last-minute agreement. You've all just been talking about how long the agreement was, but it wasn't effectively scrutinised either by UK parliamentarians or by legal scrutineers. So there's a real issue about, you've just talked about the thinness of the agreement, but from our perspective, how do we begin to retrofit accountability and parliamentary scrutiny into the processes? Not just so that we find out what's happening, but our stakeholders. You've just talked about deciding whether goods, where goods are made, how the treaty actually links into them. So I've got a couple of questions. I was wondering if members would like to come in. Christina, Professor Christina Eckes, do you want to kick off? Because you talk about the urgency of agreeing the TCA meant that it excluded alternative scenarios of national parliaments being involved in the process, being reported to, and the lack of transparency?
I mean, the adoption of the TCA was, of course, so ad hoc that there was no actual scrutiny in most parliaments. I mean, we dived into the Finnish and the Dutch and the German parliament, and only the Dutch parliament had a discussion on it, then coming to the conclusion that there were no alternatives, so that they had to move forward. So many of these provisions were not scrutinised in the traditional way, and because it was conducted as an EU-only agreement, of course, national parliaments were anyway not involved in terms of ratification. The question is, what can we do now under the current system? And I think here, the core question is access to information and access to information, timely access to information, because let us not forget, when decisions are taken at the, let's say, Partnership Council level, at the TCA level, they are in principle binding down on the parties to the agreement. So the UK, the EU, and hence they need to be influenced beforehand, and they're very difficult to change beforehand. So we are looking at a situation where if parliaments cannot beforehand influence what is then discussed at the ministerial level and by supporting experts, they act after the fact. And then even if there's disagreement, there will be no way of having a constructive influence. One can only challenge it then afterwards, which is, of course, much, much more difficult. So in my view, one must distinguish also between active and passive flows. So many people have emphasized that we have information by the Commission, that we have quite some information on what is discussed in the Partnership Council and in the specialized committees. But this is, of course, a passive putting it forward on websites. But I think what must be the situation is that beforehand, on specific issues, positions are taken and agreed with parliamentary scrutiny. So I think that is core in maintaining some accountability in the institutional structure, despite the fact that I fully agree with Catherine Barnard that the question is how much will be decided in these committees. But I still think one should not underestimate that this is the way one has accountability at the TCA level, and what is not decided there, what is really decided at a party level, parties to the TCA, that is an internal question, and I could only voice my views on the representation of the member states in the EU then, not so much on devolved administrations.
Okay, thank you. Can I move to Catherine Barnard, because you made the point about the challenge of scrutinising hundreds of pieces of legislation, and that's something we've highlighted in our UK internal market report, that we need to have more scrutiny in the Scottish Parliament and the devolved parliaments on legislation, and the time issue is critical. What suggestions would you have to retrofit the system so we include parliamentary accountability and transparency in the processes that come through the TCA?
Yes, thank you. I think your points are extremely well made. If we just break down the levels of engagement, let's start at the top, which is the Partnership Council. So Partnership Council has only met once, and I, as far as I'm aware, a second, and so it met June in 2021. As far as I'm aware, no date has been fitted for another meeting. The striking thing is about the Partnership Council is that any decision taken by the Partnership Council, or indeed the Joint Committee under the Withdrawal Agreement, doesn't need to be approved by Parliament, and there's been no attempt at scrutiny by Westminster, let alone any talk about how the devolveds might be involved in any decision taken by the Partnership Council. Moving down, you've got the specialised committees. Now, as far as specialised committees are concerned, at the moment, I think this is an area where the devolveds should be making quite a lot of noise to say we need to have sight of the agenda of these meetings well in advance. And of course, we need the minutes, but ideally, you would say you need representation on these committees, particularly the ones which are likely to touch on your areas of devolved competence, so things like SPS and fisheries. As far as the PPA is concerned, the Parliamentary Partnership Assembly, as we know, it met for the first time recently. It's a meeting between Westminster and the EU, and therefore there is no formal role for the devolveds, although you have been given observer status, albeit at the last minute. There's a very good piece by Bridget Fowler on the UK and Changing Europe website, which went up this morning, which I will link to so you can see her informed comments on how the PPA worked. Now, clearly, it was the first meeting, and so they had a lot of getting to know you to be done. I think there is a sense on both sides that they want to make it a useful forum. So then the question is, to retrofit, to use your excellent term, is how do you in the devolves have a chance to have some input into what is discussed there, even though you're not allowed to be formally present, although you have observer status?
OK, thanks. That's very helpful. Do any of the other witnesses want to come in on the issue of accountability and transparency? Dr. Zulig, did you want to come in on this issue?
Just to say, I think it's important to recognize that in the end, this is a trade deal. And a trade deal, generally from an EU perspective, is implemented by the Commission with the third country. That's the level of interaction. Of course, there are many other connections between them, but in terms of the heart of the relationship, that is dealt with at that level. And on the EU side, we've had actually a very long discussion over the last years about what is the appropriate input, what is the appropriate scrutiny of these kind of trade deals. That's why we've also had this debate around whether it's an EU-only deal, whether it touches on member state competences. The European Parliament has been very vocal in being more involved in the scrutiny, also in particular on the TCA. There has been a big movement on the Commission side to be much more transparent, much more open in the negotiation and in the implementation of these kind of deals. So there's been a lot of development on the EU side. But in principle, this is now up to the UK. The UK decides what happens on the UK side. There are some of these new mechanisms which have been put into place, like the Parliamentary Partnership Assembly. But whether that will have any real impact will also depend on how seriously it's taken by the UK government, whether it actually integrates it into the processes or whether it basically meets as a talking shop without much impact. And just my second point, I think scrutiny of EU legislation is horrendously difficult even within the European Union. And there has been a long discussion around whether parliaments within the European Union are taking their role fully when it comes to the scrutiny of EU legislation, because only some parliaments really have a structured process of doing that, which then also has a real impact on the decisions of the government when it comes to negotiations. And one of the reasons for that is because it is an enormous task. There's a lot which comes out of the European Union and a lot of technical detail as well, which is very difficult to scrutinise for any parliament.
That's really helpful. But I suppose that the conclusion that we came to with our internal market report was that although it is difficult, it is actually very important. And it's been illustrated by a couple of you today. If it's business and trade, then goods that may start off in one country but are actually completed in another country, you actually need the technical arrangements to be clear, for example, so that businesses and environmental NGOs can actually lobby us as parliamentarians and that we can then raise issues that our constituents are interested in. That was a very useful answer. Any of the other witnesses have a comment they want to come in on the importance of parliamentary scrutiny and how we might deliver transparency that we actually need in the implementation of the TCA?
Not seeing any indications.
So what I'm taking from this is that there's actually agreement that this is really important and the challenge is actually how we deliver this in practice. And from the last comments from Dr. Zulig, it's interesting to note, I think, for us here, that there's a parallel discussion in the EU about the European Parliament being involved. And I think that's something for us to take away in terms of our relations with European parliamentarians and devolved parliaments across the UK and the UK Parliament. So there's something, if you don't ask, you don't get. So thank you for that, convener.
Thank you very much. If I could just maybe ask a supplementary, and it's to Professor Christina Eckes or Ikes. We're not sure if we're pronouncing your name properly, so perhaps you could tell us. And it was about the comment you made in the first session, the first theme about the Partnership Council. And the impression I got from your contribution was that you felt that the Scottish and other devolved nations were actually part of that process and were involved in the Partnership Council and involved in that process. And so I think the PPA would be the body that would be expected to scrutinise that work, but yet the devolved nations, we had observer status. We didn't have access to briefing papers, for instance, from the UK delegation. So is there a mismatch between the way the Partnership Council is operating at government level and the opportunity for the devolved nations to contribute into the PPA?
Yes, you could say that. I mean, I would start with saying we were talking access to information and transparency. So we must, of course, know that the PPA's powers are limited to information and recommendation powers. So the scrutiny you're mentioning is already, I would say, limited. So we must acknowledge this as a starting point. But I do agree that you could say there's a mismatch in executive representation, but which is, of course, a matter of internal UK decisions of who is sent to the Partnership Council. So this is something that is not ensured in the TCA. I mean, no devolved administrations, they're in their own right. They're there representing the UK as a partner to the TCA. So that is something I honestly don't know to what extent we can say that the practice of sending governmental representation to the Partnership Council in June 2021, when it first met, whether that will be continued in that form and to what extent this is a right also within the UK. That is something I cannot speak to. But you could say that there's a mismatch between that executive representation and parliamentary representation. That I would agree with. So the question is, to what extent could that be rectified and parliamentarians sent as part of the PPA?
Professor Forrester?
Yeah, maybe I could offer a kind of summary. All of these discussions require, but at the moment appear not to have, a wish on the part of the Westminster government to pursue consensus and an attribution by the Westminster government of importance to the matter. The design of the headlight or the other component of a car, which is 35,000 components, it actually does, and they come from all over the world and they get fitted together, and that's why we have rules of origin. That matter seems not politically at the moment to be very important, but in terms of prosperity, it should be recognised as being important, and pursuing consensus on that should, though dull, not exciting, and possibly being too much communing with the Europeans or nasty to us, it would be appropriate to start by attributing importance to the reaching of technical consensus on technical matters which are not sexy but which are important for ordinary people and ordinary businesses.
Thank you very much. I'm going to move on to our next theme, which is in looking at the areas of disagreement between the UK and the EU in terms of the operation of the TAC, and a bit more perhaps about the Parliamentary Partnership Assembly. Mr. Golden.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to start with Professor Barnard, if that's okay. We've touched on lots of elements of areas of disagreement between the EU and the UK and how these might be resolved, but keen for any further thoughts on this, as well as in the operation of the TCA, how the areas, the gaps, if you like, and how they could be strengthened. So keen to kind of close off those aspects, as well as hear the panel's thoughts on how dynamic you envisage the future governance of the TCA will be going forward. So if we start with Professor Barnard, then I'll go to Professor Ekes next.
Thank you for that helpful question. So areas of disagreement, I would summarise them as customs facilitation, which is very thin, fish better than it was, mobility still real problems. The other issue is programmes, particularly Horizon. Now, the particular area of disagreement there is whether the UK can have associate membership. And this is now connected to the EU's response to the UK government's attitude to the Northern Ireland Protocol. And what I'm hearing now is that it's increasingly unlikely that the UK will sign up to Horizon. It's increasingly looking from the Treasury's point of view that the 17 billion, which it would cost us, could be better spent on setting up our own scheme. And so access to the programmes is a real problem. And I should say that, indeed, of all of those specialised committees, the one that nearly didn't meet was the Committee on Programmes. And so the UK government is saying that's one of the reasons that the EU is not fully complying with its obligations under the TCA. The other issue, I think, which is quite striking and that we'll see played out quite a lot over the next two or three weeks, is the interconnection between the TCA and the withdrawal agreement. And so, yes, the treaty does recognise in respect of remedies, dispute resolution, there is a link between the two treaties. But the UK government takes a view that this non-cooperation over, for example, Horizon, is not a legitimate way of using powers under the TCA to extend to issues which arise under the withdrawal agreement. The other thing I just would like to put down as a marker is the future. Remember that the TCA is subject to review after 5 years, so the planning for that should happen in 2024. And here again, this might be an issue that the Scottish Government would like to have some, the Scottish Parliament would like to have some say in. And likewise, the review over the fisheries arrangements in 2026, which interconnect with the energy arrangements.
Thank you, Professor Barnard. Can I move on to Professor Ekes, and then we'll go to Dr. Fabian Zulag.
Yeah, maybe I can be very brief on this and just throw in an area that where the conflicts haven't arisen yet, but where I see potential future conflicts, and that is the provisions on surrender and exchange of criminal records. they cannot be put into practice without national legislation. We see national legislation being adopted in different member states, and quite some confusion on references to the TCA, references to EU law in the national legislation. So this is an area that is very highly rights sensitive, where differences in protection may arise, and where I see a lot of potential of individual level conflicts that are really in a non-trade area, let's say, but that nonetheless are very rights sensitive.
Thanks for that. Dr. Fabian Zuleg.
Yes, thank you very much. I would firstly say I think it's important to highlight that from an EU perspective, the TCA is not completely separated from the withdrawal agreement. These are connected. There was always the perception or the actual political agreement on the EU side that the withdrawal agreement was a necessary condition to have the trading relationship, which is embodied in the TCA. So by questioning the withdrawal agreement and the Northern Ireland Protocol, it also questions the whole relationship. And that, I think, highlights that the TCA, in the end, is not only thin, it's very precarious. There are many areas where cooperation can break down. There are many review points, at which point we might see big changes. But I think also on a more general point, for these kind of international agreements, yes, they are very complex, they are very lengthy, but you cannot specify everything. And for them to work well actually requires a lot of trust, it requires good faith, it requires ongoing cooperation, and it requires a will to make it work. And I think there's a real question now on the EU side whether there is a will on the UK side to make this work in the way it was intended, to implement some of the checks, for example, on the UK side, which still are not there. And I think this also plays into the political realities in which such an agreement exists. If there isn't the agreement to move forward in a constructive way, things can become very difficult on a variety of different areas. You just don't have some of the conversations on technical standards, which you otherwise could have. You don't work quickly at the borders to make things move smoothly. You don't have the kind of discussions at the political level about how you find a way forward out of difficulties which will always arise in any kind of agreement of this nature. So I think it has to be said that we have to see this in the overall context of political realities, and there things are very difficult at the moment.
Thank you, Dr. Zuleg. Professor Forrester, do you have any thoughts?
I'd just add 2 points. One programme which should attrister, which should render sad the members of this committee, is Erasmus. That was an absolutely excellent programme from which Scotland benefited by the arrival of students, and Scottish students had the opportunity of studying abroad. And that was the basis of tremendous good. It's gone. Or at least UK and Scottish participation in it's gone, and that's a pity. Separately, just to add to what was said about cooperation in connection with crime, Lord Advocate Wolfe spoke repeatedly, and I helped organise one or two of these meetings, about the necessity of establishing adequate, effective measures to ensure cross-frontier cooperation in a world where cross-frontier crime is routine. And he told movingly of a murder where, thanks to the European arrest warrant and frank cooperation between police forces, someone was brought back to stand trial in this country for the crime of murder. Now, those are really important things which ought to have been properly addressed. They weren't.
Thanks for that. And just thinking about the TCA, what would be the consequences if the TCA wasn't in place?
It doesn't need a TCA to achieve effective cooperation between police forces or between judicial authorities. It requires an agreement between countries, and it needs to be written down, because you can't do extradition on the basis of something written on the back of an envelope. There has to be an international agreement. And the UK was cautious over the past, well, going back 35 years ago, the UK was very cautious, but gradually was convinced. And the UK and others participated in building up the network of cooperation between police and judicial authorities, which existed up until February 2 years ago. So the TCA is a framework, if people choose to use it, to build the kind of relationship which used to be there.
Okay, thank you. And final question, do we have time?
And on that point, just before you move on. Thanks.
Okay, Dr. Zulek.
I just wanted to make the point that I think while I fully agree with what just has been said, I think it's important to note that if the TCA were to break down, with also the implications that would have for the withdrawal agreement and the Northern Ireland Protocol, there would be very little cooperation which could happen between the European Union and the UK. This would affect all areas of cooperation. It would make the relationship impossible to manage.
Thanks, Dr. Zulek. And perhaps if I could stick with you for the final question, how much activity do you envisage between the Partnership Council and committees of devolved legislators?
I think this comes back to the point I made before in terms of who actually decides on how these processes look like. And from the perspective of the EU, it is entirely up to the UK government to decide how to implement consultation, exchange with devolved administrations, with devolved assemblies. This is not something the EU would have any kind of view on or any kind of input on. In the end, the Partnership Council is between the UK government and the Commission, and that's at the level at which this is dealt with. But how that these decisions, how the input into the Partnership Council are derived at the UK side, is entirely up to the UK.
Thank you, Dr. Zulek. Happy to open up to the panel on either of the last two questions, either consequences of the TCA breaking down and how the Partnership Council may operate, if there's any thoughts. Yes, okay, we'll go Professor Ekes, then Professor Barnard.
Yeah, just very briefly, I fully second that. I think the consequences would be dire and far going. I can only refer to what I said earlier of the discussions, for example, in the Dutch Parliament, what consequences that would have for areas like fishery and all areas, basically, that the TCA gives a thin but a framework for cooperation to develop further, to specify, to exchange. So I personally, while I agree, of course, that you could have exchange of criminal records and you could set up surrender of evidence and whatever in a separate agreement, I believe that the damage to the relationship would also be so deep that that is very difficult to envisage, in my perspective. As to the second point, I think I would just like to add that I have absolutely no doubt in how high regard Scotland is held in Strasbourg, Brussels, but it is an international agreement, an intergovernmental agreement, the TCA between the UK and the EU, and I think any EU partner would be very careful in mingling in the internals of the other side. So I think, in a sense, That is one thing one should not forget. Only the UK and the EU are represented in their own right under the agreement. And that is a problem for the member states to a degree. And that is also, I think, the same problem faced by the both administrations. And one should not underestimate the formality of the framework in which one cooperates and what that means for how cooperation takes place.
Thank you. Professor Barnard.
I would just say that the TCA, of course, envisaged further cooperation between the UK and the EU. It makes repeated reference to supplementary agreements. But at the moment, all of that is for the birds. You could well imagine supplementary agreements on matters like professional qualifications and mutual recognition agreements. But there is not a hint of that at the moment because of the tension. The question then is, why might the TCA break down? And I don't know if you're going to go on to ask about the Northern Ireland Protocol, but I can talk you through the reasons why the Northern Ireland Protocol may lead to a breakdown under the TCA. But there are various reasons why the TCA is described as precarious, to use Fabian's words. It's precarious, not least because the review coming up in 2025, 2026 could form the basis for the Conservative Party's manifesto to say we should leave the TCA, which we could do with giving 1 year's notice, and the review might point in that direction.
Thank you. Professor Forrester, would you like to come in on this at all?
I can't add anything to what has just been said, except to confirm, when you asked earlier about criminal cooperation, what I said is right. A country can readily enter into a deal on criminal cooperation, but what the others have absolutely correctly said is that if the TCA were not there and broke down, then such cooperation would be extremely difficult.
Okay. Thank you, panel. Back to you, convener.
I'm afraid we are running up against our time limits for this morning, but before we move to our final area, I'm just going to bring in Miss Boyett for what she assures me is a very small supplementary.
Appreciate that, convener. Thank you. It's just a quick supplementary to Fabian Zulig. You were talking about the issue of the partnership through the PPA and how it actually works. Can I just ask a quick question? Because it is clearly the UK and the EU, but what is the diplomacy for other European countries, for example, Spain and Germany, with very strong federal systems? How do they ensure that their governments and their federal systems, which have decisions taken at a subnational level, how are they properly represented in the PPA so that there's consistency in the way that we are looking for and transparency?
I think the key thing here is, from an EU perspective, this is something which has to be decided within the individual member state. A federal state has different ways of applying these kind of provisions, or different ways of interacting with the EU level. We have in some countries a very wide-ranging involvement of federal entities within European decision-making. If you look at, for example, Belgium, where the constituent parts have a very big role in a lot of these decisions, up to the point where we've seen, for example, a veto of a federal state against an international trade treaty. In other countries, it is arranged differently, because in the end, the rule at the European level is essentially you don't get involved in the internal constitutional issues of the member state. It's the member state which decides. And at the EU level, they then act as a member state.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Minto.
Thank you, convener. I was going to ask a question with regards to information flow, but I think in your previous answers, you've talked about the accountability and transparency and scrutiny in quite a bit of detail, and especially to my colleague, Sarah Boyack's point about retrofitting. So I'm interested to know what we've learnt with regard to the TCA and if its governance structures may be considered in other agreements, you know, perhaps the trade agreements, and how then the Scottish Parliament can get involved, and what can we learn from the experience that we've had with regards to the TCA, and perhaps what could be improved on. I don't know, Dr. Zulig, do you want to start?
I can't really comment on what the UK might take forward from this. I think from an EU perspective, it's slightly contradictory. On the one hand, the TCA and all the arrangements, also including the withdrawal agreement and the Northern Ireland Protocol, are very unique. It is a different way of arranging a relationship with a third country. Given the history, given the size of the UK, given the integration between the economies which was there, so it has been designed in a way, in a very bespoke way for this particular situation. But there are also elements in there where there has been a much broader debate, which I've already referred to. So when it comes to the questions of how do you implement broader objectives around environmental standards, around labour standards. The TCA, in a way, is pioneering some new ways of doing this. When it comes to questions of how does the European Union negotiate international trade deals, how does it scrutinise them, how is the decision-making process, how is transparency around that? Again, the TCA has been a bit of a pioneer on some of these issues. So I would say, yes, it is a very unique relationship, and that is reflected in the arrangements, but there are also elements there which have much wider implications and which we will find in future trade agreements of the European Union.
OK, thank you. Professor Barnard?
I think the starting point is to remember that the TCA is a trade agreement and so looks rather like the agreement that the EU has with Canada, which is, of course, what the UK government wanted. The trouble is that Canada didn't start from being very close and moved out. Canada started from being very far out and moved a bit closer in. And that schizophrenia that Fabian's just talked about, I think you see between the withdrawal agreement and the TCA. The withdrawal agreement is essentially, to put it bluntly, EU law light, whereas the TCA is essentially WTO heavy. It's got very little to do with the EU at all. But yet, of course, we look at all of this through the prism of EU membership and what we had less than 2 years ago. I think there's two things that your committee might want to consider. One is Switzerland is also having some difficult relationships with the EU at the moment because of its refusal to approve the institutional arrangements that had been negotiated. And so there is some commonality between the approach that the EU is taking to Switzerland and the EU is taking to the UK. It does bring the UK and Switzerland closer together, and indeed it may be that it leads to them having a closer and deeper relationship, which, given Scotland's interest in financial services, is something that I would suggest that the committee might want to take some interest in. Secondly, and very much longer term, you'll recall President Macron's speech about how to manage relations with its neighbours, Ukraine obviously being the country principally in its sights, but he does allude in his speech to the UK. And one of the things that Scotland might think about, and indeed you did some very interesting work on this in the immediate post-Brexit period, is what does a Europe of concentric circles actually look like for an important neighbour to the EU, but one which is recalcitrant?
Thank you, and I think that ties in with Dr. Zulik's comment about the soft power and the relationships that we can continue in these respects. Professor Eckes, have you got anything to add?
Just the general point that the TCA is an example of the deep and living trade agreements that are concluded nowadays. And if you acknowledge that fully in its extent, there's a good reason to say that we need a comparative level of accountability and transparency and access by parliaments than we do to legislation, because despite the fact that the institutional structures maybe are not as proactive as one might have feared at the moment the TCA was concluded. So we have spoken about how little the committees have actually met and how little negotiation has happened there. They create the potential. So there's a framework of an external executive governance structure, and that must be taken seriously. So I think my main advice would be to embrace that these are the new generation trade agreements, and they externalize decision-making and governance to an executive level that needs to be scrutinized timely and scrutinized in formalized agreements of access to information. And the argument behind that is simply that they're quasi-legislative they at least may have the potential to be quasi-legislative in their impact on national law and all in all areas basically that they touch upon.
Thank you, and I suppose that ties in with perhaps this committee meeting with our equivalents in Northern Ireland, Wales, and as we started earlier this week, some of us met with the PACAC committee in Westminster, so better coordination between the committees and parliaments across the UK. Professor Forrester.
I don't have much to add except to suggest that the elephant in the room is one of approach, and that is the political difficulty of making a choice between the supposedly irreconcilable policies of sovereignty and prosperity. In other words, a difficulty that we have is that the UK government's approach to relationships with other countries, as exemplified by the TCA, hinders the resolution of the daily problems which neighbours have to confront. And that's a great pity.
Thank you.
Thank you very much to our witnesses this morning. That's been extremely helpful to our deliberations. I'm going to suspend for a very short 5 minutes, and we'll return for our third agenda item. Thank you.
Welcome back. And we now move to a third agenda item, which is to consider documents leading connection with the powers in Section 1 of the UK withdrawal from the European Union Continuity Scotland Act 2021. Referred members to paper 2 in their packs. The committee considered the draft policy statement and draft annual report and reported our recommendations in November last year. I will now invite and thank you to Spice, who have provided an analysis of the revised documents against our recommendations, and invite any comments from members. I think Mr. Cameron, you want to.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you to Spice for the very helpful paper they provided the committee. And I also would like to put on record my gratitude to the Scottish Government for making various changes in light of our report. However, Convener, I do note that they haven't acted on certain points that we raised in relation to transparency and scrutiny. For instance, it's not clear from the draft policy statement how the Scottish Government will make decisions about what EU law to align with or not. There's no commitment to set out which EU laws the Scottish Government has considered from an alignment perspective but decided not to align with. And in my view, we do need more transparency on which items of EU legislation the Scottish Government has looked at and considered for alignment and in what way. Because Parliament will want to have a proper overview of those areas where there has been a choice to align or not align. And if the decision has been not to align, then Scots law will have diverged from EU law. And I think it's important that we are advised of that and know that. I appreciate, Convener, time is very short, but I do think it important that the committee put on record in a letter to the Scottish Government those points. Thank you.
Okay. Ms. Boyack.
Thank you very much, Convener. Yes, I also welcome the fact that there were responses to several of the points that we made in our report. But I was disappointed in three areas in particular. The issue about not agreeing with our committee recommendation of updating the Scottish Government website to give us information in terms of where it intends to align with EU law. I think that's a challenge, not just for us as a Parliament, but for stakeholders, so that people can understand what changes are likely to be made, particularly in the context of the discussion we've just had with witnesses about the challenge of tracking the TCA and how important that is for businesses, agricultural sector, fishing and environmental lobbyists, which I think is really important to get legislation right. I was concerned that there wasn't agreement on flagging what consultations had actually been carried out and the suggestion this wasn't proportionate. I just thought that cuts across the transparency and accountability element. And I would like a bit further comment from the government, because it avoided a direct comment on the proposal we had of a memorandum of understanding between the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament to deliver effective scrutiny. Very conscious, there's been a lot of very good work by our clerks and Scottish Government officials, but I think that's something that would really add to clarity and would help people manage timescales. For example, how the monitoring of keeping pace powers could actually be effectively monitored for the purposes of transparency. And just to log that on the consultation issue, it wasn't just our committee, the REIN committee also considered that important. So I think that's important for us to log. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, Mr. Ruskell.
Thanks, Convener. I would echo those points. I mean, I think in terms of, you know, the government's legal duties is one thing to flag up where there's been active alignment, but clearly alignment is much greater than that. And you know, an example which is currently out to consultation is the Scottish Future Catching Policy for Fisheries, where it appears, reading through that there's alignment with the principles of the Common Fisheries Policy, but when you actually look at the detail of what's being proposed, you could argue that it's actually divergence in terms of the landing obligations. So it's not really clear in consultations like that whether the government is seeking active divergence or not. And I think that's something that we absolutely need to, you know, all committees of this Parliament absolutely need to keep a handle on. And that goes way beyond the reporting mechanisms that we currently have. So, like other members, I hope the government will reflect on that. We don't you know, sleepwalk into one direction or another, and there's active consideration. Stakeholders are clear
where there is alignment and where there is proposed divergence, which I don't think we have at the moment.
Any further comments, or anyone not in agreement with the comments that have been made? I think the suggestion of Deputy Convener to write to the Government on her concerns is the way forward, and if the committee are minded, if the clerks can draft that and leave the approval of the letter to myself and the Deputy Convener, we'll take that forward on behalf of the committee. Okay, and on that note, we move into private session for our final agenda item. Thank you.